There might be more of the periodic table inside of you than you think. There also might be more of the periodic table inside of you that actually does something to keep you alive than you think. And to unpack that concept, we're going to pull a magic school bus and shrink down to microscopic size to understand how the body works. Across the breathtaking savannas of hemoglobin and the beautiful beaches of thyroid hormones, we will find massive herds of carbon and flocks of hydrogen. And if we're very quiet and look very closely, we'll also see some of the rarer elements that are just as vital for our health. Of the 118 elements on the periodic table, about 90 of those occur naturally on Earth. And just 6 get most of the credit for keeping living things alive. Together, we call them schnapps. Carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, phosphorus, and sulfur. And each of these elements exists naturally as individual or pairs of atoms, but they're more useful to us when they mix and match into molecules that we know and love, from the relatively simple water to the rather complicated DNA. We're mostly made up of water, so if you counted up your atoms, most of them would be hydrogen, and if you measured by mass, the majority would be oxygen. But if we dive deeper beyond the sea of schnapps, we can celebrate the other atoms that keep this ecosystem ticking. First, if you look through that synapse over there, yes, it's a gaggle of charged atoms, or ions, that are totally vital. Calcium, sodium, potassium, magnesium, and chlorine are not as famous as the schnapps collective, but they're not exactly rare either. And they have a lot of jobs around the body, like keeping your neurons firing, and your cells properly hydrated, and your bones strong. Altogether, these 11 elements make up more than 99.9% of you, but that other 0.1%, that contains something like 40 to 50 other elements. These are called the trace elements. We're talking iron, iodine, zinc, silicon, and even some lead and uranium. Because if it's in the environment, it can get into you when you eat, drink, or breathe, even if it's just for a little while. But figuring out which of these elements are bioessential, or necessary for the body to stay healthy, is a topic of ongoing debate in nutrition science. There are even different definitions of what qualifies as bioessential at all. Some experts say that if an organism can't grow or survive without a given element, and it's involved in the way that the body like builds up or breaks down molecules, then it's essential. Meanwhile, others are more specific and require that 1, it needs to be present in human tissues, and 2, that its absence causes harm, and 3, that reintroducing the element can stop the damage. Depending on who's counting, there's about 20 to 25 bioessential elements. And after you account for the main 11, that leaves us with about a dozen bioessential trace elements. And to spot them on this play-pretend safari of ours, we'll begin at the local watering hole. Because just like every creature needs to venture out for something to drink, every nutrient we consume gets around via our local waterways, that is, our bloodstream. And the bloodstream is where we'll find what might be the most familiar bioessential trace element. At any given time, most of us have about 5 grams of iron inside of us, but about 70 to 80% of all those iron atoms are found in one specific place. Look, right over there, it's a red blood cell, but more specifically, it's the hemoglobin inside the red blood cell. So hemoglobin is a protein, a large, complicated molecule that has a very precise structure so it can do its job in the human body. In hemoglobin's case, that includes ferrying oxygen molecules around the bloodstream, and it's the iron atoms that the oxygens get proverbially stuck to for their journey. Watch now. Now, as the dutiful hemoglobin iron passes its precious oxygen cargo to its iron in an eager myoglobin protein in the muscle tissue. And incredible, it also picks up carbon dioxide, a waste product from that muscle cell, and carries that back to the lungs to exhale. Just look at that hemoglobin go. In total, our bodies use iron in more than 500 different proteins, so there's even more it can do. We just don't have time to cover them all. And we've known for a long time that not having enough iron feels terrible. Fatigue, dizziness, shortness of breath are all symptoms of anemia, and people have been treating it with iron supplements since the 1600s. But iron is far from the only metal in a healthy bloodstream. And if you just look a little bit to the left over there, you'll catch a glimpse of another bioessential trace element, copper. Most of the copper in your blood is carried around in a molecule called ceruloplasmin. It's made in the liver, and once it makes it to your blood, those copper atoms can get added to a variety of other proteins that do a bunch of other jobs around your whole body. For example, you can't produce hemoglobin without copper there to help. Isn't that ironic? Ironic? No, Alanis, that's not what ironic means. We've been over this. So copper helps with everything from bone strength to the production of melanin and collagen in the skin to maintaining the myelin sheath outside of a neuron that helps the signal travel quickly. So a copper deficiency looks very similar to an iron deficiency, but it also comes with nerve problems. That said, you're probably eating more than enough copper without even trying. It's present in foods like meat, shellfish, mushrooms, and nuts. And unless you have a rare inherited condition where copper builds up in your body, you don't really need to worry about how much copper you're eating every day. Speaking of which, that brings us to our next destination, the gut. It's absolutely teeming with elements, including cobalt. No, not the blue stuff, don't eat that. That form of cobalt is toxic. So is the red stuff while we're at it. Instead, we get our daily dose of healthy cobalt atoms from them being tucked inside an unassuming group of vitamins called cobalamins. You've probably heard one of them go by the name of vitamin B12. And luckily, our lovely host of this safari just ate a vitamin B12 rich meal of sardines, salmon, peanuts, butter, and molasses, which is definitely a choice. Like copper, cobalamins play a supporting role for certain proteins, including the ones that make DNA, red blood cells, fatty acids, and the building blocks of other proteins. It's also important for nerve and brain function. But if we need more B12, we can't actually make it ourselves. We have to get it from our diet or from supplements. The good news is we don't actually need very much cobalt. Just only 80 to 300 micrograms of B12 are present in the body at one time. And the recommended daily intake of cobalt is about 6 micrograms, which makes this a rare sighting. Fantastic. And as we head from the stomach into the small intestine, look over there. Do my eyes deceive me? It's molybdenum, which some of you may have forgotten is even an element at all. Maybe that's because molybdenum is only present in 4 proteins in the human body. But now you may be thinking, out of the thousands of proteins in the human body, how bioessential can these 4 really be? Well, molybdenum proteins help break down toxins and waste, and people whose bodies can't make these proteins can suffer from severe seizures and usually die in infancy. And like other bioessential trace minerals, the importance of molybdenum goes beyond the human body. Scientists say that the genetic instructions to create these molybdenum proteins is highly conserved, which means that it's similar or the same across all living things, and it evolved way back in the history of life. During the early Jurassic period, there was a drop in ocean molybdenum levels that may have helped cause a global extinction event. Now, I think that's all the bioessential elements we're likely to see today. We'll have to look out for iodine, zinc, fluorine, boron, and all the rest next time. But what about the bio-maybe elements, the ones hiding in the shadows, waiting for recognition? For that, let's take a quick detour towards the spine and check out some silicon atoms vibing in the discs between this person's vertebrae. Scientists used to think of silicon as inessential in the human body, and some still do, but there's evidence that suggests it may help prevent the buildup of aluminum. Oh right, aluminum. That's another element in the human body, just one that isn't bioessential. In fact, some studies have found a link between high levels of aluminum and Alzheimer's disease. So if silicon reduces the buildup of aluminum, it might be protective. However, aluminum's link to Alzheimer's disease is still being debated, just like silicon's like essentialness. And you shouldn't worry about everyday sources of aluminum, like soda cans and cooking utensils. But besides that potential benefit, having low silicon is associated with having low levels of other elements that are definitely essential. So some experts argue that this means that it's plausible silicon is also essential. And research has tried to show silicon's importance to bone health, but most studies on its nutritional value were performed in small animals, so don't really necessarily apply to humans. So the jury's still out on whether silicon will join the ranks of recognized bioessential elements. Maybe it'll have the opposite fate of chromium, which was once thought to be bioessential but has since been demoted. It's now considered to be pharmacologically active, which is like the nutrition science equivalent of recategorizing Pluto as a dwarf planet. Having chromium in your body might have some positive effect, but going without it won't kill you. So what changed? In the 1970s, a lot of nutrition science focused on altering what lab rats eat. For example, when researchers put rats on a diet of torula yeast, the rats developed liver disease and impaired glucose tolerance. Adding selenium into their diet fixed the liver disease, qualifying it as an essential element. And to fix the rats' impaired glucose tolerance, the researchers turned to brewer's yeast and pork kidney powder, both of which were high in chromium, so chromium also got classified as bioessential. But in addition to the whole rats aren't people problem, those early experiments don't meet modern standards. For one thing, the scientists never measured the baseline chromium in a normal rat diet, or the torula yeast diet, so how could they judge the effects of a low chromium or high chromium scenario? And unlike the other elements we've talked about so far, chromium isn't present in any human proteins. It might have a role in controlling blood sugar and cholesterol levels in rats, but evidence in humans is inconclusive. But that hasn't stopped companies from selling chromium supplements and making claims about how they'll help you with weight loss and muscle building, all while conveniently leaving out the risk of them damaging your DNA. Nutrition research has come a long way since the 1990s, when chromium supplements were a fad and researchers were investigating the nutritional role of lead and arsenic in low levels. Because yeah, toxic elements exist in nature, so they're gonna get into your body just by you living. But spoiler alert, as far as the EPA is concerned, the healthy amount of lead and arsenic in your diet is zero. They're definitely in you already, but please don't go licking lead pipes or industrial waste. And most of the essential elements are only useful when they're embedded in specific molecules, so don't go adding electronics and sand and pennies to your diet either, because leafy greens and legumes will do the job a lot better. You may not be able to get the entire periodic table inside of you, but believe me, you don't want to. That's the kind of life lesson that we wouldn't be able to get out to the masses without our incredible Patreon patrons. If you support SciShow over there, thank you so much. And if you don't, you can still support us anyway by liking and commenting on this video and subscribing to our channel. Thanks for watching.